Through the Kwandwe Rhino Conservation Trust, our main focus is on the black and white rhino.
In 10 years' time, I would like to see the population doubled itself. So that in the future, my great-grandchildren will know that our granddad protected these animals. They saw there are so many of them. But if we don't do that, the rhinos will just disappear.
Yeah, so we out now. There are about 3-4 vehicles currently looking for a white rhino cow and a calf. We put one of our new smart collars on this animal about 5-6 months ago, and we got an alert late last week. She had been in quite a bad fight with one of the bulls. I think the bull was trying to mate with her, and she was trying to keep the bull away from her calf. And through that whole process, she got a couple of injuries, and the bull managed to get his horn between her leg and the foot collar. The plan will be to dart her from the chopper, have a look at any of those injuries. They do look superficial, but you never know, so we'll have a closer look at some of the injuries from the fighting, and then we'll redeploy this collar with a new belt. So that's kind of what we're up to now, the first step in that process is to find the right animal that we're looking for.
These collars have really revolutionized the way we do things. We've struggled for a long time in specifically rhino conservation to find a tool that is going to assist us as much as these collars can. They give us real-time information when there's abnormal behavior. So it's not just a GPS tracking device. There's artificial intelligence embedded in there with a machine learning algorithm, which learns the baseline behavior of each individual rhino. And when there's an abnormal data from that baseline, it triggers an abnormal behavior alert.
Fancel, you see those two on your 11 o'clock?
Yeah, I've got them, thanks. Okay, we found her. She was in this western corner in Eka.
Okay, great news. We found her, and she's not in the best area, as you can see, I'm sure, through the window. It's pretty thick down here. Okay, so the dart's in the mob.
Okay.
Yeah, so the calf was darted about a minute after the mom. So the mom usually stops first, but then the calf will come back to its mother.
Got volume already.
Let that leg go a little bit. Let the leg go a little bit at the back. I see blood coming down from the in between her legs. Watch out. It's okay, sweetie, no, stay down. Stay down, girl. Come, sweetie, there you go.
Yeah.
Happy with anesthetic.
Anesthetic's good. Heart rate's 88, stable. Blood colour's okay.
You can actually see where the injury was. There's a hole in here from where the horn went into the back of her leg. So what must have happened is the horn went either through the belting of the collar or actually in between the collar, I think in between the collar and the ankle. And when it poked off, the collar luckily had that weak point, because otherwise it could have caused way more serious damage. The collar broke off, but there's a nice puncture wound higher up on her leg here from where the horn's gone in. So we're gonna have to get this collar on and then treat that wound. Perfect, well done, guys.
Yeah, so the collars that we put on these rhino go on the ankles. Rhino have a very strange shaped head, and so a neck collar doesn't work. Also, historically, we've been a little bit nervous about ankle collars because of injuries that they have caused, very rarely, but can cause. I think where these collars are slightly different is that the actual housing swivels on the strapping. And as we saw, case in point with this one, there is a weak point. So if a stick or a horn from another rhino gets in between the ankle and the belting, it'll break off. Because most importantly is, we're putting them on to protect the rhino. We don't want to injure them in the process.
That's too tight. And we're going to need a small plate, please.
Something went wrong. Please try again.
Sorry, Siri. I don't know if you know how to deal with this kind of dilemma.
And that black bag.
See, I think that's fine because she's also, her foot's not straight. I'm trying to try and move her foot a bit. Yeah, happy with that. Perfect.
They are so very good. It's a good way of technology that has brought to us, because if there's a trouble with a rhino, let's say they are fighting, then the collar will tell us the ups and downs of the rhino. It sends an alert to us, okay, this rhino wasn't happy last night, so we go look on that area, what's going on with this rhino.
We're finding that every alert is worth following up on, because even if it's not something that's life-threatening to the animal, we're still learning.
So it's more like now the collars are doing the monitoring themselves.
We wanted to have a look at her, but the main goal was to put the collar back on so that we can remotely monitor her. And I'm really glad that we did do it in a short period of time as we did, and we managed to find her and carry out the procedure, because we found a lot more substantial injuries than we first suspected, especially in some of the softer bits underneath, which we couldn't see from the ground.
Okay, so she's got a horn cut that extends from between her back legs. It goes right down into her udder, and then it has gone in here by 3 inches.
I'm really glad we managed to get her onto a course of antibiotics, got her some vitamins. The wounds are draining, which is a good sign. And hopefully she'll be okay. But now that she's got the collar back on, we're able to monitor her at hourly intervals. So we'll be able to keep close eye on her. Yeah. These boys behaving badly late at night, eh? We've all heard a lot about poaching and sometimes too much, but regardless of the fact, it's at its worst. And partially because it's a different type of poacher that we're dealing with, and they're coming prepared to kill not just one or two rhino, but to really hammer areas systematically. And with this new type of poacher, we also have to adapt.
Poaching is a very big threat. We can't relax at all. That's why we always try to find all these technologies that can help us to prevent poaching.
The drone is something that we've more recently added to our whole integrated rhino response system. So the thermo-imaging drone, it will fly, it gets programmed with the same coordinates that the collar it generates, and then it automatically flies to that location where it sends us a live feed of what's going on the ground. So that really helps us make the right decisions as to whether it's a counter-poaching incident, if it's an injury, and it allows us to direct and keep our guys on the ground safe, because it might be that an animal's down, but their poachers are still there. Or it might be that an animal's down, but there's another animal that's in the area. Or there could be a pride of lions, or there could be a buffalo. And so it really gives us oversight in the bush where you normally don't have that. So from a ranger safety, from an animal safety point of view, the drone is really an important part of the whole system. Before we had this collar system up and running, we wouldn't have known that there was an injury to this animal. Normally an internal infection like that on an animal like a white rhino can be life-threatening. So who knows, we might have lost that animal. We've tried for a number of years to find a system that works, and we really believe that we've got one now. We see a massive application for rhino conservation in general, and not just in South Africa, in Africa. reserves are all faced with the same problem. And if we can have a solution like this one, which can help other people, that's where we'll already, you know, see the scale of this, and hopefully it'll help rhino conservation at a much higher level.